I want you to raise your hand if you grew up, thank you, Levi. I want you to raise your hand if you grew up with siblings. A lot of people here grew up with siblings. So what I'm about to say now, you'll probably understand a bit more if you had siblings. So I grew up with three older brothers. I'm the youngest of four, no girls in the house. So you can imagine it was pretty chaotic and rowdy all the time, but it was a lot of fun. And if you grew up with siblings, you probably have heard this phrase before or something like it. I grew accustomed to hearing this phrase. Why can't you be more like your brother? Right? You know, your parents say that, and sometimes it's in a funny, joking way. Sometimes it's when they're actually being serious and they want you to do better. Or maybe it's something like, I bring home a report card and I have C's and stuff on it, and then my brother brings home a report card, and because he's a nerd, he's got all A's. And then they ask me, why can't you be more like your brother? You know, it's one of those questions that when you don't understand it the right way, it can kind of be hurtful. Because as a teenager or as a young child, what I heard whenever my parents asked this was, why aren't you as valuable as your brother? Or I don't love you like I love your brother. Or sometimes maybe even, I don't like you like I like your brother. If you grew up with siblings, you might know that feeling a little bit. And I want to suggest to you, and I recognize that everyone's family life is not perfect. And I know that everyone's parents aren't perfect. I know that none of our parents are perfect. And you might have grown up in a house where that was actually the case, where maybe your parents did show favoritism. Maybe they didn't love you the way that they should. But I'll suggest that majority of the time, that's not actually the case. You know, as a young child, I was hearing something like, I don't love you like I love your brother. But in actuality, my parents weren't comparing the value between me and my brother. They're comparing the action. And it's not that they love me any less because I made a mistake, or they love my brother any more because he did the right thing, but they're saying, why can't you be more like your brother? Because they want you to do right. Not because you mean any less to them. Not because they like you any less than they like your sibling. But because they want you to grow. And they want you to choose right. So maybe it's not that you have any less value than the one you're being compared to, but maybe it's something like a righteous comparison. You know, a lot of times we're told don't compare yourself to other people because that's not what you need to do. But in actuality, there's some times where there's righteous comparison. And that's why we have role models in life, because we look up to people who we're comparing ourselves to. We try to imitate that person so we can grow. And maybe when our parents are saying this, it's not because they are unrighteously comparing us and bestowing on us a value that God hasn't bestowed. But maybe it's that they're comparing our actions so that we can do better. I want to look in Genesis chapter 4. In Genesis chapter 4, you have the story of Cain and Abel. And if you didn't grow up in the church, or if you didn't grow up going to a lot of Bible classes, you probably still heard a little bit of something about Cain and Abel. What we know about them, I'll summarize a little bit of it, is that they're two of the sons of Adam and Eve. So they're one of the first people to ever be on this earth. They're brothers. And what's going to happen is Cain is a worker of the ground. He's kind of like a farmer. He grows things. That's his trade. That's his job in the family. And Abel is a shepherd. So he watches the lambs, the sheep, the animals and stuff. So they're both going to bring an offering to God. Cain brings one of what he knows. He brings one of the ground. And Abel brings one of what he knows. He brings one of the animals. And it says in verse 4 and 5, it says, and Abel also brought of the firstborn of the flock and of their fat portions. And the Lord had regard for Abel and his offering. But for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. So Cain was very angry and his face fell. Some translations say that his spirit fell. He was upset. And what's happening here is this. We don't know exactly why God didn't accept Cain's offering. We don't know what exactly was wrong with it. You know, I've heard some people say that, well, you're supposed to offer up an animal, a burnt offering, so Abel did it right. But, you know, if you look in the Levitical law, there's offerings for grain, there's offerings for animals, there's offerings for a lot of stuff. So it might not be that, and they didn't even have the Levitical law at that point. So we don't know exactly what it is that Cain did wrong, but what we do know is that God accepted Abel's sacrifice. God didn't accept Cain's. And essentially, when he tells them, you know, Abel did it right, Cain did it wrong, I don't think it's taking too much liberty to say that God is kind of thinking, why can't you be more like your brother? And it's not in a way that's comparing them unjustly. It's not in a way that's saying that Cain's any less valuable because he did the wrong thing, but I think the problem here is that Cain has a misunderstanding of who God is. There's three big mistakes that I would say that Cain makes in this section. One is that he offers the wrong sacrifice. And two is that after this happens and after he gets angry, he's going to murder his brother. Two pretty big mistakes, I would say. But there's a third one that I feel like we don't talk about. And it's right in the middle of those. The third mistake he made is that he didn't understand who his God was. And because of that misunderstanding of who God is what led him to making the bigger mistake of killing his brother. And in the same way that when I was compared to my siblings and they say, why can't you be more like your brother? I didn't have an understanding of who my parents really were and the love they really had for me. So that drove me to making more mistakes. Because that drove me to thinking that they didn't love me the way that they really do, when in actuality, all they wanted me to do was choose to do right. The mistake that Cain made, the biggest mistake I would argue, is that he didn't recognize who his God was. He didn't recognize that his God is a patient God. All semester, we've been talking about this idea of knowing who God is. The theme of the whole semester is know God. And what Cain didn't recognize about his God is that God is patient. And what does that really mean, right? Because we use patience in a lot of different ways for us. You know, I'll say that you're patient if you have some sort of pet peeve and you don't let it get on your nerves. I was talking with Ari the other day, and one of our biggest pet peeves that we share is when you're playing cards with somebody and they start bending up your cards and it drives me up a wall. I can't stand it. And someone bends up my cards. And having patience would be not getting upset with this person because they did this thing that bothers me. Or patience could be the ability to wait on something, right? Abraham had to wait 25 years for God to fulfill the promise that he told him he was going to do and give him a son, so much so that he grew impatient and went and did it the wrong way and had a son that he wasn't supposed to have. Patience can be waiting on something like that for us, but I think patience for God is a little bit different, right? Because God doesn't really have to wait on things, at least not in the same way that we do. I don't think God has these little pet peeves that he has to try to look over so that he can love somebody more. I think God's patience is a little bit different. God's patience is more like this. He understands that we're not perfect and that we need time to grow. And that we need time to learn. God took the children of Israel out of Egypt, and he led them through the wilderness for 40 years. Not because this was a 40-year walk, but because he knew that time in the wilderness was crucial to them learning who he was. And then when they got to the promised land, they still didn't know, so he took them for another 40 years because he has the patience to know that we need to learn. And that takes time for us to learn. What Cain didn't recognize is that when he messed up, God knows we're going to mess up, and he's patient enough to help us grow anyways. One thing that I admire about my dad is that he displays this kind of patience, and maybe not patience in other ways all the time, but he's a tutor. He tutors people. Well, that's like his side thing. He tutors people in upper-level math classes and computer classes, so like differential equations and upper-level calculus stuff and physics and all this stuff. Like, he tutors people in these incredibly hard classes. And what I admire about him is that, well, when you're a tutor, it's like a step further than being a teacher. Because a teacher, to be a good teacher, you have to be good at explaining something, right? Well, to be a good tutor, you have to recognize that the person you're tutoring didn't get it the first time. And they might not get it the second time, and they might not get it the third time, but you have to have the patience to know that it's gonna take time for them to learn. And out of all the things that my dad taught me in life, one of the biggest things is that when you're teaching someone, you're gonna have to have patience to know it's gonna take time for them to learn. And God is exactly like that times a million. He knows you're gonna mess up. He knows you're not perfect. But what you need to know about him is that he recognizes that, and he sent his son anyways. He recognizes that, and he loves you anyways. He recognizes that, and he's willing to be patient enough for you to learn and for you to grow anyways. Here's the message I want to leave y'all with. Here's the what I urge you all to do is to know who your God is. Because like Cain didn't know who God was, it sent him to do something worse than what he had even done before. I don't want the same for you. And I'm not just preaching you, I'm preaching to myself as well. And I tend to be hard on myself when I mess up, but one thing I need to recognize is that God's patient with me. And that's not to say that making mistakes and sinning is okay, but it is to say that even though you mess up, God's gonna love you anyways. And even though you mess up, God gives you value anyways. And God is patient enough to help you learn. So know who your God is. Let's pray. God, we're grateful to you that you are patient with us, that you love us, and that you recognize that when we're not perfect, all we need is to draw closer to you. We're grateful that you give us the opportunity to have a relationship with you, and I ask that you prick the hearts of everyone in this room and urge us all to grow closer to you every day. God, we love you. We're grateful that you sent your son so that we can live with you for all eternity. It's your son's name that we pray. Amen.